there are so many skincare options available, it can be hard to know which products you should be using. But which ingredients are really going to make a difference to your skin? What should you be prioritising? This 2021 paper is an update on something first published 2014, the skincare pyramid. Often, I'll see patients who have just leapt to the top of the skincare pyramid, so they're going to be using ingredients which maybe contain stem cells or peptides, and they think that they're doing the best thing for their skin, but they've missed out a whole really important level, which is the base of the skincare pyramid, protect. This week we're going to be covering that layer of the skincare pyramid. We're going to be talking all about protection. Next week is renewal, and then the week after is regeneration. As you would imagine, at the base of the pyramid we'll have protection and repair. Previously this would have been through the use of products such as a vitamin C and also via the use of an SPF. However, things are a little bit more sophisticated now. Let's take a look. Back in 2014, the real buzzwords were protection against UVA and UVB. But now we're also looking for protection against near infrared, blue light, and the visible light spectrum. And although no new sun protection ingredients have been approved by the FDA since 2014, the formulations themselves have changed somewhat, as I am sure you were aware yourself. I remember previously vainly struggling to find an SPF that I could use that would not clog my pores and make my acne worse. Now it seems like there's a real bounty of non-comedogenic SPFs out there. The visible light spectrum accounts for around 40 to 45% of the electromagnetic radiation emanating from the sun, so you can see why it would be important to protect against this. In addition, it's responsible for more pigment darkening in Fitzpatrick's 4 through 6 than UVA is, thus leading to challenges in the treatment of melasma and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. We would typically be looking for a product containing either zinc oxide or titanium dioxide in order to scatter the light, something which is particularly important for people with a higher Fitzpatrick skin. It's somewhat of an irritation, therefore, that products containing zinc oxide and titanium dioxide have traditionally left a much more white and chalky cast on the skin. If you're someone with melasma who has a darker skin type, you may want to consider this product, Fernblock, which has been shown to improve visible light-induced pigmentation. It's a botanical ingredient derived from Polypodium leucotomos, which sounds like a Harry Potter spell. Shazam! For those of you who are curious, yes, I am in fact related to Nymphandora Tonks of the books. Infrared A accounts for almost a third of all the electromagnetic energy reaching the Earth. It causes an increase in skin temperature and an upregulation of reactive oxygen species. These reactive oxygen species cause the coarse wrinkles that you see in people who are repeatedly exposed to high temperatures. When I first heard about the impact of blue light or digital light pollution on the skin, I thought, wow, that is pretty crazy. So there are these porphyrin-containing enzymes and flavoproteins which have light-activated receptors on them which get activated by the blue light, which disrupts the mitochondrial energy chain. As you're probably aware, there are a lot of new skincare products out there which propose to improve the respiratory effort of the cell. So just when you thought it was enough to be thinking about cleanse, tone, and moisturizing, you got to be thinking about your respiratory chain reactions, your ATP production. I mean, is this a joke? For blue light, you've got to be using an opaque blocking agent or something like Fernblock. So we're talking about things like pigments, charcoal, red algae. Another big problem is pollution, especially if you're living in a larger city. These pollutants can cause reactive oxygen species in the skin, as previously mentioned. The issue with both air pollution and smoking is the nanoparticles, which directly harm the skin. And one way that you can get around this is by wearing an SPF, sunscreen, or even a foundation. This stops the nanoparticles from physically touching the skin. These nanoparticles activate aryl hydrocarbon receptors, which sounds like something that I'm just making up. This causes hyperpigmentation, damage to MMP1, which leads to collagen breakdown, and also damage to keratinocytes. You might have noticed that some sunscreens will also contain antioxidants. The idea behind this is that the antioxidants will help to reduce the reactive oxygen species and help the SPF to work better. They have been shown to reduce the reactive oxygen species by 2.4 times in SPF 15 formulations. That would be something like a retinol, a vitamin C, a vitamin E, or a green tea extract. Oh, weird. One of the really hot ingredients in skincare right now is nicotinamide, which is a type of vitamin B3. This prevents the ATP depletion seen after UV exposure, and it boosts the cellular energy. This also enhances the DNA repair activity, and this is something that you're going to see a lot when we are talking about skincare formulations now. As an aside, people often ask why they shouldn't maybe just use a simple formulation of a granactive retinoid, for example. What's the benefit of using perhaps some of these more expensive cosmeceuticals? And in many cases, it's because they often contain additional stuff that will help you with your anti-aging regime. If you don't have the budget for it, of course, no one is expecting you to spend more than you can on your skincare. That is plainly ridiculous. However, if you do have the budget for it and you're buying this stuff anyway, you may as well make sure that it is something which is giving you the most bang for your buck. So I've mentioned it several times already, but this product, Fernblock, has been shown to reduce the amount of DNA damage caused by sun exposure. There's something found in bacteria and plant cells that is not found in mammalian cells called a photolyase. Essentially, this uses blue light to repair DNA damage, which I know, again, sounds like a really hocus-pocus concept, but it's a thing. These DNA repair enzymes can be delivered directly into the skin using liposomes of less than 150 nanometers. A brand new concept in protection and repair is the microbiome. So there isn't one normal microbiome which has been identified. The microbiome on your skin will vary according to age, sex, body location, and also UV exposure. There are a lot of skincare products out there now which are supposed to help with pre, pro, or postbiotic supplementation. There is not a whole lot of information out there at the moment on the skin microbiome and what using these different formulations might do to it. But I think this is going to be a really important area to watch. So let's revisit this in a while. It's actually really hard sometimes to say which category a good product will sit in, because it will often take elements of various points of the skincare pyramid and stick them all into one product. A multitasking thing. One of the products that I particularly like is Advanced Alto Defense by Skin Better Science. You would think this would fit very neatly into the protect category. However, it's not quite as simple as that. As you would expect, it contains vitamin C and E. Not that exciting. It also has an anti-pollution complex. Okay. It also has something in it called LLPQQ, which is the brand's own proprietary technology. It's their own invented antioxidant, if you like. But this particular antioxidant is effective against the body's own intrinsic processes. So most of the other products will be active against extrinsic things, so things like UV or pollution. This is an antioxidant which works from the free radicals that you're producing. It also hits some points from the other layers of the skincare pyramid. For example, licorice extract from level 2, which helps to brighten the skin, and a peptide, which helps to improve the skin's firmness and resiliency, which is of course from the top section of the skincare pyramid. Many of the newer products are really much more hardworking. This is my favorite SPF. It doesn't look that exciting when you first look at it. Okay, it's active against UVA, UVB. It's a really good makeup base, but it's also active against pollution, infrared, blue light, visible light. Contains peptides to stimulate collagen production. It's also quite widely available now, so you should just buy that one. I just mentioned this product because it's the cleanser I'm using right now. It contains coenzyme Q10 and superoxide dismutase, which of course are going to be active against free radicals. It also contains lactic and salicylic acid, so it hits the base of the skincare pyramid and also the second layer. Do you need to use a fancy cleanser like this? Probably not. Is it a nice thing to use if you can? Sure, yeah, why not? So that's it for this week. Next week, we're going to be talking all about the renewal section of the skincare pyramid. In the meantime, don't forget to let us all know by typing in the comment section below how you're getting on with the protect section. I'll see you again next week.